Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. कृष्ण प्रस्ताय भूतले श्रीमती भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी की नामने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे और भवानी चरणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय Morning, we're reading Bhagavad Gita as it is. Chapter 9, the most confidential knowledge, text number 13. Mahatmanastu mam partha Daivim prakriti mashrita Bhajanti ananya manaso Yadva bhutadim avyayam Mahatmanastu mam partha Daivim prakritim ashrita Bhajanti ananya manaso Mahatmanastu mam partha Daivim prakritim ashrita Bhajanti ananya manaso Yadva bhutadim avyayam
Stop it.
Sarvam Parijana Saritam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakha Nikamscha He Krishna Karna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namaste Tapta Kanchana Kolange Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sike Devi Radhami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpata Rubhyascha He's describing to us the activities of Mahatmas. And Srila Prabhupada sometimes would refer to all the devotees as Mahatmas. But you are all the Mahatmas because you have surrendered to Krishna. You have taken shelter of the spiritual energy. Right? You're under the protection of the Daivi Prakriti. So Lord Krishna has three principal energies. There is the spiritual energy, the superior energy, and then there is the material energy, which is the inferior energy. And the third energy is the tatastha, which is all of the living entities. Living entities are all marginal by nature, meaning that we can either reside under the spiritual energy or under the material energy. Krishna gives us that freedom. We have free will. It is not force, but our own choosing. So when we choose to reside under the spiritual energy, then Lord Krishna reciprocates. It's a special protection which the devotee receives. Just like we see Vasudev and Devaki in the prison house of Kamsa. And of course, Devaki had given birth to children, one after another. And they had each been killed by Kamsa. The scriptures tell us that these children were the Satgarbhas, and they appeared within the womb of Devaki as a result of a curse. Initially, the Satgarbhas were the sons of Marichi, and as the sons of Marichi, they had made some offense. They had committed an offense against Lord Brahma. They had observed Lord Brahma being lusty and chasing after his own daughter. So this was certainly improper behavior on the part of Lord Brahma. But the sons of Marichi, seeing him behave in this way, they laughed at him. And as a result, because Lord Brahma is a superior personality to them, so they received reaction for that. And their reaction was that they became demons. and they had to take birth. First of all, they took birth in the family of Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu was their grandfather. They were the sons of a demon named Kalanimi. And as the sons of Kalanimi, they worshipped Brahma. And they worshipped Brahma that they would not be killed by any demigods or any Gandharvas or any other of these residents of the higher planets. They were demons. And they were afraid that they would be killed by these residents of the higher planets. So they directly worshipped Lord Brahma. And when Hiranyakashipu, their grandfather, found out about this, then he was very angry. That he said, "Oh, you bypass me. You don't care about me. You go directly to Brahma and you want to get blessings from him." So he cursed them. Again, you can see the problems you get, you know. You offend superior persons, even you're a demon, and you offend a superior demon, you get cursed again. And so they were cursed again, and this time, the curse was that they would take birth in the womb of Devaki. And in the womb of Devaki, they were killed by Kamsa. And Kamsa was Kalanini. So their own father came as Kamsa and killed them when they took birth from the womb of Devaki. So this was how the Satgarbhas were eventually liberated back to heaven. Yeah, they were finally liberated because when they were, after being killed by Kamsa, then they went to reside in Sutala Loka where Bali Maharaj was residing. This is one of the subterranean hellish planets. Subterranean hellish planets are more opulent than even the heavenly planets. And Bali Maharaj was residing there, and the Lord was his doorkeeper, and the Satgarbhas went there. So it happened, after the death of Kamsa, Devaki had to get some... what happened was, after the death of Kamsa, Devaki and Vasudeva sent Krishna and Balaram to Sandipani Muni's ashram for their education. And while they were being educated in Udupi, Sandipani, or at that time it was called Avanti, now it's called Ujjain. So Sandipani Muni observed the power of Krishna and Balaram. He understood that they were very, very powerful personalities. So after teaching them, he requested Guru Dakshin. And he made a very unusual request. He said, "Some time ago, my son died when he was bathing in the sea. We lost him. So he said, can you bring him back to me? Bring someone back from death." And this is a real test of your divinity. If somebody is actually God, you know, then okay, don't just show the universal form. Bring someone back from death. Someone who's died, you bring them back again. And Krishna and Balaram duly went and found the son of Sandipani Muni. First of all, they went to the sea and they couldn't find him. At that time, they killed the demon Panchajanya. And then they went to Sutala Loka and they got him. They went there, met Bali Maharaj, and told Bali Maharaj that we want to take his son, the son of our guru. Is that right? Yeah? And bring him back. So that when they heard about this, then Devaki also said that you brought the guru's son back. You have six big brothers. You should bring them back also, because I lost your six older brothers at birth. So you please bring them back for me. And Krishna and Balaram duly did that. They brought them back for Devaki. And When they came back, then Devaki, seeing her six sons, milk began to flow in her breast, and she fed her breast milk to them. Now, when Lord Krishna was born in the prison house of Kamsa, Vasudeva had taken Krishna away from Devaki to the home of Nanda Maharaj and exchanged Krishna with Yogamaya, who had taken birth from the womb of Mother Yashoda. But before Vasudeva took Krishna to the home of Nanda Maharaj, Devaki thought that it's such a long way to go from Vrindavan to Gokul to Nanda Maharaj's home, that certainly my child, my baby, will get hungry. So she fed some breast milk to the baby before he took the baby over to Nanda Maharaj's home. So in this way, the breast milk of Devaki became Krishna Prasada. So when the Satgarbhas came, and they also drank the breast milk of Devaki, it was Krishna Prasada. So they all got liberated, and they could go back to the heavenly planets. You see? So I was talking about Devaki because she's an example of a soul who surrendered to Krishna. When the seventh child appeared in her womb, she was fearful. What will happen to my child? Because Kamsa has already killed six of my children. Certainly he will want to kill this one. But Devaki, in her fearful condition, she surrendered to Krishna. And the result was Krishna protected her. Not only her, but the child was also transferred. The child, of course, was Lord Balaram, and he was transferred to the womb of Rohini. So this is an example of Devi Prakriti. When we surrender to Krishna, then Krishna reciprocates. He protects the devotee from the material energy. We are tathasta. We are marginal living entities. Actually, by nature, we are the superior energy. We are Prakriti, but we are superior Prakriti. We are meant to reside in the spiritual energy. But we are very small, right? Mame Vamsha Jiva Loke Jiva Bhuta Sanatana. We're eternally fragmental parts of the Supreme Lord. So fragments, tiny parts of the Supreme Lord. And because we are very small, minute in nature, therefore we easily become covered by the material energy. Although the material energy is inferior and we are superior, but because we are very small, we have that tendency to become covered by the material energy. Prabhupada gives an example about sparks coming from a fire. That the spark also has heat and light, like the fire. Now the fire, a big fire burning, will not be put out even if there's strong wind or rain. If it's a big fire, it will keep burning because you put a lot of fuel there. So even though there's some wind and little rain, it won't put the fire out. But the sparks which come out of the fire, they can easily be extinguished because they don't have the same quantity of heat and light. Although they may have the quality of heat and light, the quantity is not big enough to maintain the heat and light, and so they are extinguished. In a similar manner, our spiritual nature is easily extinguished in the association of the material energy. Therefore, it is mentioned here that the Mahatmas, they will associate with other Mahatmas, and in the association of like-minded people, they will be engaged in spiritual activities. We take the association of devotees for that purpose, to associate with the spiritual energy. It is said the nature of the qualification of a devotee is described in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Krishna Das Kaviraj says the devotee will give up the association of asat Krishna. The devotee of the Lord does not want to associate with the material. We have satsang here today, satsang. We are associating with the eternal, with the divine spiritual energy by speaking and glorifying Krishna. But asat is the material, and when we associate with the material, then naturally we will fall under the influence of the material energy. Our spiritual nature will be covered. In the presence of the sun, there is no darkness. But in the absence of the sun, then darkness is everywhere. So Krishna is like the sun, and Maya is like darkness. Where there is the sunlight, there can be no darkness. Where there is Krishna consciousness, there can be no Maya. So Srila Prabhupada is making this point in the purport here, that when one surrenders to Krishna, then he takes shelter of the spiritual energy. Surrender to Krishna. Of course, this is one of the main topics of the Bhagavad Gita. And we see the conclusion in the 18th chapter where Krishna requests Arjuna to give up all of his religion and simply surrender to Krishna. And Krishna promises that, I will protect you from all sinful reactions. Do not fear. So Krishna is making the same claim, that when we surrender, he will give protection, just as it's mentioned here, Daivi Prakriti. We're protected by that divine energy, the spiritual nature, because we've surrendered to Krishna. But Krishna also explains earlier in the Bhagavad Gita that as you surrender, I reward you accordingly. So, in proportion to how much we have surrendered, Krishna reciprocates. Prabhupada said, you think of Krishna 10 minutes a day, Krishna will think of you 12 minutes a day. You think of Krishna 4 hours a day, Krishna may think of you 5 hours. And if you think of Krishna 24 hours a day, Krishna will think of you 26. Krishna reciprocates with our surrender. And what is that surrender? Anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya vachana. First, we have to accept whatever is favorable for devotional service. Just like coming here on Sunday morning. This is certainly favorable for your Krishna consciousness. There is surrender Sunday morning. Probably most of you are not working and the children are not going to school. So you could think, oh, I can just sleep, right? That we have that free will. But we also know, well, if I just simply sleep, I will be in the association of Maya. It is just ignorance, right? Prabhupada would say, sleeping is like death. And Prabhupada was very careful to minimize his sleeping. We know how Srila Prabhupada lived, sleeping only a couple of hours a night, waking up in the middle of the night, time to do this translation work, Prabhupada was constantly telling the devotees also, don't sleep, because Prabhupada was constantly traveling everywhere and preaching. So sometimes very senior devotees, often sannyasis, were traveling with Prabhupada, and they would feel exhausted. Sometimes we hear Shruti Kirti Prabhu was serving Prabhupada, and he would tell how they would come from one flight to one temple to another temple, and it would be very demanding. They were doing a lot of moving, traveling, preaching, and Prabhupada didn't seem to be affected by it. We didn't hear Prabhupada say, I feel jet lagged, I have to rest. Prabhupada just kept going. And Prabhupada would tell these sannyasis, you're sleeping, don't sleep. And he would tell them about the Goswamis, Nidrahara Vihara Kadi Vijito, that they controlled their eating and sleeping. They regulated their eating and sleeping. They were not controlled by it. So, this is something of the symptoms of one who's surrendering to Krishna. And just like all of us, we've come here Sunday morning, we've surrendered a little bit. It is actually very good for our Krishna consciousness that we gave up our association with Maya to come and associate with Lord Jagannath here on Sunday morning. Of course, we don't want to just only think that Sunday morning is my day for Krishna. But Krishna consciousness is a constant affair. We want to all the time be associating with Krishna. We're not just a Sunday program. We have programs every day. Every morning there's a Mangal Arti. Every morning we have Tulsi Puja and Guru Puja and Bhagavatam class. And also Prasadam too. Prasadam is there every day. And so we encourage all the devotees. Even if you can't come, maybe it's much easier of course to come on Sunday because not so much traffic. And we know in Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur, the traffic is quite a problem. Driving, not easy to come, especially on weekdays, because a lot of traffic. So that is one problem, one realistic problem. We can't argue about these things. But we encourage devotees, even if you're not coming here, you have to have your own program. You have to do your own devotional service. It goes on wherever you are. It's not that only in the temple we do hearing and chanting. But wherever we go, we want to be engaged in these activities. Chanting, reading scriptures, offering prayers. We want to cultivate the association of Krishna, right? Devotional service has to be uninterrupted. It goes on without any break. No holidays, right? Now it's coming up to a big holiday in Malaysia. The children are thinking, oh, no school for a few days, you know. They're feeling good about it. And even workers are getting a holiday because National Day, is it? National Day. So a few days holiday. So we enjoy holidays, right? But in Krishna consciousness, no holidays. Right? No days off, every day Because devotional service itself is a holiday, right? We don't want to give up our devotional service. When we're getting pleasure from something, then we want to keep doing it. We don't want to stop. We want to keep doing it. It goes on. We want more of it, in fact. The more we do it, the more we want. And chanting the holy name is meant to be like that. We know that in the beginning, difficulties. But keep chanting. And gradually, you get the taste. We have to make a program. We have to be regulated to do this hearing and chanting. No matter what the situation, no matter it's hot, or no matter it's cold, it's wet, or it's dry, you're at home, or you're away from home, you want to keep the regulation, chanting and associating with Krishna. So this is surrender, accepting everything which is favorable for devotional service. Some things are more easy to accept than others. Just like offering people prasada, not difficult, right? People generally, everybody likes to eat. Everybody has to eat. And we enjoy nice food. So offering people prasada, most people generally will accept prasada. You offer them a book, we know that's a bit more difficult. You try to distribute a book, people say, oh, such a big book. Do you read such big books? I had a Bhagavad Gita, I gave someone a Bhagavad Gita. Such a big book? You can read a book like this? This is only one, right? We have many. And we want you to read all of them. And we should have a program to read Prabhupada's books. This year in Mayapur, we had one sangha. It was a sangha between the sannyasis and the GBC and spiritual masters. And the conclusion of the sangha was that we want to emphasize and we want to encourage more the reading of Srila Prabhupada's books. That generally we find that devotees and people in general are not reading the books enough. And Srila Prabhupada often used to say that I am writing the books for the devotees, not just for you to sell, but for the devotees to regularly hear and discuss. Very important for us to be regularly hearing and chanting. Very nice example, maybe you know that family, the Guptas, who live in Boise, in USA. So that one couple, I can't remember their spiritual names, but they had two sons. And they decided they didn't want their two sons to go to school, but they did homeschooling. Now in USA, homeschooling is encouraged, it's very much encouraged. And so Mrs. Gupta, both initiated devotees, her husband and wife, Mrs. Gupta taught the two boys at home. And she taught them using Prabhupada's books. She taught them everything from Prabhupada's books. English, language, history, science, everything. It's all there. It's all in Prabhupada's books. And those two boys, they went on that they entered university when they were about 14 or 15 years old. They graduated from university when they were like 17 or 18. And they went on to Oxford, and one of them finished his PhD. He's now a professor in a university in USA. And the other one, he's doing research somewhere also. So, just to give you an example, of what can happen when you read Prabhupada's books carefully. You get everything. As Krishna says, everything comes from me. And Prabhupada has given us everything. And it's all there in his books. Right? People sometimes ask Prabhupada, what will happen when you die? Prabhupada said, I will never die, I will live forever by my books. So Prabhupada's written word is particularly important and powerful. And all of us need to associate with Prabhupada's written word, reading Prabhupada's books. There are some devotees who have a program to read the whole Srimad Bhagavatam every year. And the one devotee I know, he calculated how many pages he has to read every day to finish the Bhagavatam in a year. And it's 40 pages a day. So he has a regular program as well as chanting and doing other service. Every day he must read 40 pages of Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, if some of you would like to read Srimad Bhagavatam, if you haven't read the whole Srimad Bhagavatam, then this is what you have to do. You have to read 40 pages a day. How long does it take? It depends on you. Now, I'm not saying that you have to do that, but some people like to do this. Anyway, certainly gives you a regular program of hearing chanting. However, reading Prabhupada's books is not a mechanical thing. It's not just sitting and reading and then, okay, I read my 40 pages, that's it done. It can become mechanical. Just like we're reciting Shikshastikam here this morning. So you may be able explained, we simply repeat. So we want to not only just repeat, but we want to go deeper and to understand what is being told, what is being said in these prayers and in these books. Srila Prabhupada writes in a purport in Srimad Bhagavatam that more important than simply reading is discussing and explaining with devotees. Another temple, so I was in one center there after the class, she said, well, I don't like to come to some of the devotees who give, they're not very, I said, the devotees about it also give class, yet to other people giving classes, just like in Srimad Bhagavatam, by the sages, in Naimisharanya. And it's explained there in the first chapter, the qualification of the speaker and the qualification of the audience. That the audience also have to be qualified. Just as the speaker has to have realized this key, to hear more clearly. And think, when is Prasadi about class? And how to improve it? What needs to be said? These are all also duty of the audience. The audience is no service, not but also by hearing. So you're also hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. You can also be pure devotees. Maharaj Parikshit is a great soul. He was a great soul. He went back to Godhead. All of you, just simply by hearing, can also go back to Godhead. But hearing is not just physical presence, but it is participating in the topics. And we see Shonaka Rishi, who is the head of the sages in Naimisharanya, he's often standing up and speaking, and he will glorify the speaking of Srimad Bhagavatam, and he will speak something about the topics of Lord Krishna, and he will talk about foolish people like Grihamedis who are busy talking so many mundane things and who waste their time. So he's here. He's not the main speaker, but he's enlivening the whole subject matter of Srimad Bhagavatam. So like this, we want you all to understand the business of a devotee, accepting what is favorable for devotional service and giving up what is not favorable. What is not favorable for Krishna consciousness? And we say one of the things is gramya katha, nonsense talk, or the talk of the village. We know in the village, when people get together, they're talking the village talk. Oh, what happened in the village? Oh, did you hear about that person? Did you know what he did? Do you know what she said? Like this. This is all what we call prajalpa, which Prabhupada translates as nonsense talk. So it is said, nonsense talk breeds nonsense thought. And nonsense thought is the cause of nonsense action. And by nonsense action, then we get again birth and death in the material world. So therefore, very important is to discipline our tongue. Of all the senses, the tongue is the most voracious and difficult to control. It is very difficult to conquer over the tongue. But you, dear Lord Krishna, are so kind that you have given us this nice prasada just to help us conquer the tongue. So this prasada is not only foodstuffs, it is also hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, topics of Lord Krishna. That is also prasadam for all of us. Hearing the message of the acharyas, the great devotees, how they engaged themselves in the service of Krishna, and how they gave up everything which was not favorable for devotional service. It's not just giving up meat, fish and eggs, intoxication, gambling, and illicit sex. There are other things which are not favorable for Krishna consciousness. And one of the major problems is this prajalpa. We talk about people or about. This is also prajalpa. And when Prabhupada would hear this kind of prajalpa, he would become very disturbed. He had one servant, the servant's name was Upendra. Upendra, he's left the body now, but he was a very dear soul. He rendered intimate service to Prabhupada, but sometimes he would talk things which Prabhupada didn't like. Prabhupada sometimes would overhear his prajalpa. And Prabhupada called him into the room and told him, "Why are you talking these things?" And then Prabhupada reminded him, he said, "Upendra, I know you can recite many nice verses from the scriptures. You know many slokas. Why don't you recite these? Why are you talking this prajalpa, talking about others?" So this is how we can discipline our tongue. Use the tongue to recite verses from the scriptures. Actually, we want to train, if you have children, you want to train the children to recite scriptures. I remember previous years we had sloka contests with the children, right? All the children would come and recite slokas, different levels. Do we still do that?
We have a national
quiz. Yeah, very good. Yeah, we need to encourage, and often when we teach the children, that's how the parents learn. We don't usually just sit ourselves and learn, but if you're teaching the children, then you get an opportunity to learn, because by teaching them, you also have to learn. So it's important for us to do these kind of activities, reciting slokas, reciting the Vedas. This is how we associate with the Lord of goodness. And if we don't associate with the mode of goodness, we in the mode of passion and ignorance, talking about others, talking negative things, which doesn't do any of us any good. But if we're speaking about Krishna, reciting, just like this verse, this is a well-known verse, 9th chapter, many nice verses. We want to be familiar with all of these verses in the Bhagavad Gita. Prabhupada said we should recite a chapter a day. Now some people may recite the Sanskrit of one chapter. Some people may prefer to recite the translation. Some people may even read the purports if they have the time. But if you do one chapter a day, 18 days, you finish the Bhagavad Gita. And if you do it 8 or 10 times, then you start to know the Bhagavad Gita a lot better than before. I don't need that phone. You can put it in your mobile phone. You think, right? And you should be listening to the chant. This is how we develop our spiritual nature, how we become situated under the divine energy. We want to get the mercy of Krishna. We want Krishna is like this. We have to start using our mind to think of Krishna. It's the mind on Krishna. Maharaj Ambarish was doing many devotional activities, but the very first thing he did was to fix his mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. And we do this when we were thinking how to remember Krishna. Where's my mobile phone? Where's my Bhagavad Gita? Let me read Bhagavad Gita. Let me recite some verses from Bhagavad Gita. We know there are some people who've been devotees for years and hardly know a verse from Bhagavad Gita. Even sometimes people hardly know how to sing Guru Vastikam. I was shocked. I was in Mayapur and I was teaching Bhakti Vaibhav. Now Bhakti Vaibhav is studying Srimad Bhagavatam. And it means the person has already studied Bhakti Shastri. But what happened was, one of the students was attending a morning program and I asked him to sing Tulsi Puja. And he said, "Oh, Tulsi Puja, where's the songbook?" "Where's the songbook?" I was shocked. "What? You're in Bhakti Vaibhav. You're studying Bhakti. Bhakti Vaibhav is for, you know, people who've already finished Bhakti Shastri, already studied Bhagavad Gita and everything. And you don't know the words for the Tulsi Arti? How is it possible?" These things happen. You don't live in the temple. You don't come to the temple program regularly. Maybe sometimes you've never been to Mangal Arti, so it means you've never seen Guru Vastikam. So it means you don't know the Guru Vastikam. And that's quite outrageous. If you're an initiated devotee and you don't know these kind of things, it's not good, right? So we want all of you to understand what is the duty of a devotee. This is our devotional service. Chanting these prayers, taking part in this worship, and studying scriptures. This is the business of a devotee. It's not very difficult. But you have to do it. It takes surrender. Saying no to Maya. Another quote of Prabhupada, he said, "The problem of my disciples is they're not afraid enough of Maya. They think they can associate with Maya and not be affected." And this is very dangerous. We're thinking we can deal, play with Maya, just like children want to play with fire. You don't let your child play with fire, but we play with Maya. We think, "Oh, it's okay, you know. We go to the movies, watch some mundane movie, It was okay. We go to parties, and it's always okay. Some deviations here and there. You have to be careful. We have to be on guard if we really want to surrender to Krishna. Of course, it's a question of who is serious about devotional service. If we are serious in our Krishna consciousness, if we want to actually take shelter of Krishna, then some things are required. And it requires surrender, taking shelter of Krishna, accepting what is favorable and giving up what is not favorable. We have to also know only Krishna can protect us. As Prabhupada mentions here, we don't worship demigods or ordinary people. We don't even think of, we're not even attracted even to the four-armed form of Krishna. We simply worship Krishna in his two-armed form. That's the supreme form. Sometimes Prabhupada will say differently in purport, but in this particular purport, he's saying devotee will only think of Krishna in his two-armed form. So only Krishna can protect us, and only Krishna is maintaining us. Krishna is the maintainer. We are all maintained by Krishna, not by our own intelligence, not by our hard work, not by our efforts, not by any other, not by the government certainly. Who's maintaining us? Simply Krishna is the maintainer. And we should have no desire other than the desire of Krishna. That is also surrender. What is Krishna's desire? And then there are six items of surrender finally. What should always remain? Meek and humble. These are the six items of surrender listed. We want to get shelter from Krishna. We have to qualify. We have to follow these six items. And then we are under the protection of the divine energy. Don't think Mahatma, you have to be a, you know, a saffron robe with a big beard or anything. No, ordinary people, all of you, you are also Mahatmas. And you can just improve the quality of the Mahatma. Become a greater Mahatma by surrendering more fully. Okay, so we will ask, is there any question? 5 minutes left. If there's any question or comment from anyone. Yes, Manjit? Do you have a mic for her? Is there a microphone? Another microphone? You'll have to speak loud then. Accept everything which is favorable for devotional service and reject everything which is not favorable for devotional service. These are the first two. I spoke at them in great length. And then, know that only Krishna can protect us. Then fourthly, only Krishna is maintaining us. And the fifth one is to have no desire other than Krishna's desire. And the sixth one you mentioned, to be meek and humble. These are the six items of surrender. And they're mentioned in the purport of 18th chapter, verse 66, where Krishna is speaking about surrender. Marichi Guru, can I ask a question today? Marichi is always a good audience participator. Regularly questions.